Well, when I was a boy, my dad used to pick me up after school. I was about 11 years old in Geneva, Switzerland, and he'd drive me across town to the site of the Large Hadron Collider in Geneva, which was called the European Center for Nuclear Research at the time. It's where they discovered the Higgs boson a few years ago. And there was a remarkable man there called Raphael Carreras, who used to give lectures, weekly lectures. They were called in French Science pour tous, which means science for everybody. And there were people from all walks of life who attended these lectures. There were schoolboys like me, janitors at CERN, and professors, I don't know, housewives, a whole mix of people who were attending this stuff, who gave up their lunch hour. They were also working people. And this, there were two things that struck me about these lectures. The first thing was that people were doing this not for any personal benefit. There was no credit, there was no remuneration, but that they were just doing this because it interested them. And I thought this was rather wonderful and sort of put a light bulb in my head that maybe you could go through life doing what interests you rather than what doesn't interest you in order to then do what interests you. You could sort of short circuit things. And the other thing I liked is that Dr. Carreras was always encouraging. I'd often go and ask him questions and so on. And he never looked down on me as a kid. You know, he was always, there weren't any stupid questions. You could go and ask him anything, and there was always stuff to be learned. And I like this environment so much. I think it set me on the path to ending up here where I'm a professional scientist talking to you. And even before then, my dad used to read me stories from the Winnie the Pooh books. And there's a picture here of the Winnie the Pooh and Piglet searching for a heffalump. A heffalump's a very rare and unusual thing that had almost maybe never been seen. But they got circumstantial evidence here. They've seen footprints in the snow, and this is encouraging them. Maybe if we continue to work a little bit harder, maybe we can find this thing. So the basic difference between me and Winnie the Pooh in this picture is that he's looking down and I look up for a living. And so we scientists, in particular the subject of this talk, is to look for the first stars and galaxies to form after the Big Bang. They're rare and unusual objects. We think they were very different to the stars and galaxies that we can see around us today. But we think they're there. We have circumstantial evidence that makes us think that they're there, so the quest is worth following. So I've told you these two anecdotes, maybe a bit from my life, in order to give the idea of a timeline also, that I sit here today and I look in my past, as we all can, towards when I was born, and you can see maybe significant events that shaped your life. And what's remarkable is we can do the same thing for the universe. So the universe originated in a Big Bang. We don't know exactly what banged or how it banged, although a couple of weeks ago we had some indications if you follow the science news. But we know when it banged to amazing accuracy. So we know the Big Bang, which was the creation of time and space, matter and light, happened 14 billion years ago. We know the exact number to 1% accuracy. And as I was glancing back into my past at the start of this talk, we can do the same thing here in astronomy, because light travels at finite speed. So when we look up at the sky, we're actually looking into the past. And for most cases, it's not so relevant. In the case of the moon, it's like 2 seconds. When you see the moon, you see it as it was 2 seconds ago, because that's how long it takes light to reach us from the moon. Naked eye stars that you can see if you go out in the desert away from the strip, they're maybe a few thousand years. You see them as they were a few thousand years ago. But the most distant object that you can see with your naked eye, which is the Andromeda galaxy pictured here seen through a telescope, is actually 2.4 million years ago. So the light has taken 2.4 million years to reach you. Even without the aid of a telescope, you can see this object. So if you wanted to know what it looked like today, you'd have to wait another 2.4 million years. And so the history of astronomy has really been the history of developing telescopes and technology to be able to push further out into space and see even more distant and remarkable things. This is a picture of an object known as the Coma Cluster, many thousands of galaxies like the Milky Way. It's so far away that it's seen 250 million years ago, roughly speaking. So 250 million years ago here, there was a deep sea, a deep inland sea. We know this because we see the Kaibab limestones at Red Rock. We see these also just downstream from Glen Canyon Dam at Lee's Ferry. And these tell us the idea of what was happening here was very different. It wasn't a desert, it was an inland sea. But we don't see the thing itself. We have circumstantial evidence, the rocks. But here we're seeing the thing itself as it was 250 million years ago. So I've drawn sort of a timeline on the slide where you have today and the Big Bang. And the green arrow shows you when the Earth formed. So the Earth is a relatively recent addition to the universe. It's only been there for a third of the existence of the universe. For two-thirds of the time, our solar system wasn't even there. So how far back can we actually look with our technology? So I've drawn here a little red square on this slide, which shows the field of view of the best instrument that we've built to be able to do this, which is, you've certainly heard of it, it's the Hubble Space Telescope. And the Hubble Space Telescope has a very small field of view. In other words, it takes a very small picture of the sky at a time, about 1/100th of the size of the moon. If you want to picture that, that's like holding a grain of sand at arm's length. It's a very, very small part of the sky. And scientists had the idea to try and probe back in time would be to take a picture of the sky, but to take 2 weeks to observe one part of the sky. This was a remarkable idea, to look at a nondescript, not a part of the sky where we thought there was anything interesting, but just to see what's out there. And what we found was remarkable. So here's one of the most famous images ever taken in astronomy. It's a Hubble Ultra Deep Field. In an area the size of a grain of sand held at arm's length, you see 10,000 galaxies here. They're not stars in our Milky Way, they're separate individual galaxies, like our Milky Way. In this image, about 10 of them are seen as they were 13.3 billion years ago, which is to say the light started on its journey long before the solar system ever formed. For most of that journey, the sun and the Earth didn't exist. And you know, the sun and the Earth formed, and then life evolved and so on. We built telescopes, boom, and we captured this light. It's utterly remarkable. But those are not the first galaxies. Remember, we're looking for the first stars and galaxies. This is one of the major scientific adventures, I think, of the 21st century, which is going to play out in the next 10 years. And so we sit here and we look at this Hubble Deep Field. How do we select then the 10 galaxies, the 1 in 1,000 galaxies that are the most distant? It's so simple that I thought I'd just tell you today. Is what we do is, it's not a technical description, we take a picture at visible wavelengths of the Hubble Deep Field and one at infrared wavelengths. And the galaxies which can be seen in the infrared image but cannot be seen in the visible image, those are the ones. There's just a few of them, there's just 10 of them. Those are the ones that are seen 13.3 billion years ago. So to summarize my story so far is, if I can get the next slide, there it is. We sit here in the Milky Way and we look further and further back with more sophisticated telescopes, and we look further and further back in time, 13.3 billion years so far with the Hubble. But we have another piece of information, which is the cosmic background radiation. The cosmic background radiation, which is seen at radio wavelengths, tells us what was happening in the universe only roughly 500,000 years after the Big Bang. So we know there was a time from the stuff, the outermost shell that's colored sort of green and yellow and blue there, that there was a time when there were no stars and galaxies in the universe. That's what that tells us. But it tells us another important thing, which is that on its journey, this light on its way to us was modified by stars and galaxies, the first generation of stars and galaxies that we haven't yet detected. That's our sort of Heffelump effect, the footprints. We see the footprints of the things we're looking for, but we haven't seen the thing itself yet. And so in order to find these things that we're looking for, we need to devise new tools. And the history of astronomy has been the remarkable improvements. We've been at it, you know, for 400 years with the telescope. Galileo's telescope had a lens, you know, about this big. And this is the next generation of telescopes being built in Chile. This is a European extremely large telescope. We're sort of running out of names for telescopes now. but the mirror, I can't imagine everything. The mirror is about the size of this room. So it's a gigantic tool for looking back into space ever further. As you saw from before, we need visible and infrared light in order to study these objects. And in the infrared, we're building what is the successor to the Hubble Space Telescope, which is what's called the James Webb Space Telescope. This is just 1/6 of it shown here. So it's a gigantic instrument. It's so big that it won't fit into a rocket. So they're going to have to fold it up, sort of like insect wings or something, put it in there, send it out into space, take it out, unfold it, and then it's going to take what we hope are the images of the first stars and galaxies. It's also going to explore planets and other things that are of great interest to us. So what do we expect to find? Well, the way we do astronomy is illustrated a bit in this video here, is astronomy and science is a constant dialogue, really, between theories or our conjectures about the way things ought to be, which is shown in the movie here, and the way they actually are, which is shown in the stills. So in the movie here, you can see two galaxies like the Milky Way and Andromeda that are in a collision. This is a calculation done in a computer. Once in a while, they freeze the movie, and because it's a computer simulation, you can view it any way that you like, and then they try and compare it to to actual images of galaxies nearby to see how good a job we have at understanding interactions between galaxies. Now, in the case of the most distant stars and galaxies, we've only done half of this. We have our conjectures, but we don't have the observations. So what can we expect to see? How is this going to play out? Based on the history of astronomy, I think I can best tell it with an anecdote, is Howard Carter, when they discovered Tutankhamun's tomb, they were in a sort of narrow corridor, and he was the first to see the tomb in modern times. And he had a candle, and it's sort of in the flickering light, he could see these vast array of treasures of gold and statues of animals and things and so on. And the others behind him, he didn't say anything, and they were like, "What do you see? What do you see?" And he said, "Wonderful things, wonderful things." And I think that's what we can expect in our science in the future. But as well as learning about the universe, which is going to be tremendously exciting, I think science teaches a lot about our humanity, ourselves as human beings. There's, for those of you who don't know the Pooh story, the punchline to this one is they actually didn't find the tracks of the heffalump, unfortunately. They were looking at their own tracks in the snow. But they learned something about themselves on this adventure and about what they were. And we do this too when we do science. We learn our position in the universe, but we also learn about ourselves. And the European Center for Nuclear Research, which has several Nobel Prizes have been awarded there, I didn't tell you this part, was built really out of the ashes of Europe after World War II. Europe had been at war. I'm an immigrant from Europe for, you know, most of the 20th century for reasons that weren't clear, but all these countries for religious, cultural, ethnic, you name it, reasons were at each other's throats. And the idea is, well, maybe there's another way. What if we work together? What if people from these countries that had been at war showed that by working together, overcoming our prejudice, we can do good science? And the history of CERN has shown that when you do this, you can achieve wonderful things. Wonderful things. Thank you.